either physically or spiritually, as I said. To live is to have iman, and to die is to lose iman. Subhanallah. And then Allah narrates how some people from the children of Israel, they asked a prophet of them to send them a king, under whose leadership they would fight in the way of Allah. So Allah chose for them a person, one of their best. He said, your king is Talut. He has been chosen by Allah based on his piety, on his righteousness. They said, no, he cannot have leadership upon us. Look at human beings. They are all the time like that, except the believers, of course. So here, they said, no, how can he have leadership upon us? You see, we are more worthy of leadership than he. And he doesn't have enough money. He's not rich, you see. So, and anyway, he was imposed upon them. And the prophet proved that he deserves to be their leader because Allah gave him strength in his body, and he has knowledge as well. Two qualifications of leadership in Islam: to be strong and to be knowledgeable. Subhanallah. So he also brought to them remnants, miracles from the times of Sayyidina Musa and Sayyidina Harun. You see, at home, where there were remnants from Musa, maybe Asa Musa, the stick of Musa and other things, carried by angels. So they submitted reluctantly, hatefully, and they went under the leadership of this man. And then he said to them, look, before we fight, there is a test. Here is a river we will come across. Those of you who drink from the river will not follow me. When he saw most of them drinking from the river, he said, well, unless you take 2 pounds. Except you take a little bit. Anyway, they passed the first test. When they faced their enemies and they found their hosts, they became afraid and they wanted to run away. You see, then he spoke. كم من فئة قليلة غلبت فئة كثيرة بإذن الله. This is a rule. How many times it happens that a few people who fight in the way of Allah جل جلاله, and we have a case, today is the 17th of Ramadan, the occasion of غزوة بدر. بدر, the first battle in Islam. I got something to share about غزوة بدر. For those who know it, to remember, you see. So Allah establishes a rule here. It so happens so many times that very few people who are really believers, they will overcome too many people who are not believers. And all of this by the permission of Allah, by the leave of Allah, bi-idhnillah, wallahu ma'a as-sabirin. And then they supplicated to Allah when they moved against their enemies, and they finished them. And Sayyidina Dawood, one of the subordinates who became a prophet and a leader later on, a king, he killed the leader of the enemy, Jalud. And Allah gave him kingship. What a lesson indeed for people to emulate and to imitate. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among the believers who seek help and support all the time from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And now we come to غزوة بدر الكبرى, which happened like today, the 17th of Ramadan, in the second year after Hijra. Let us come and live together the battle of Badr. Now the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he planned and fought. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he fought battles. And all in all, the battles were 47 battles. All the battles that were fought and planned by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sometimes he would not attend the battle. He would send someone and he would nominate him to be the leader and he will go with an army and fight. The Prophet participated in 27 out of 47 battles, almost one half, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this battle, the Battle of Badr, it is called Badr after a well on the way between Medina and Mecca, closer to Medina though. It is south of Medina, north of Mecca, or in the middle. As you travel, even these days, they tell you, and they stop at Badr. That is a place, still as it was, since the Prophet Muhammad's time, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, now that the immigrants, when they immigrated, Quraysh took all their wealth, didn't allow them to take anything when they immigrated from Mecca to Medina. So they had that feeling of being deprived of their rights, almost all of them. And one example, for instance, when Suhayb al-Rumi wanted to immigrate, he was, as his name indicates, from Rome, a Roman person. He came to Arabia and he was one of the people, of the leaders of the Romans. His father was something. So he immigrated from Rome and he was taken as captive, sold as a slave in Mecca. As a man, he raised Islam, he had nothing. And subhanAllah, with the pass of time, he made a wealth. He became rich. So he wanted to emigrate with his wealth and go out. Quraysh intercepted him. They stopped him. Where are you going? How can we leave you when you have that money? It is ours. You collected it from us. Either you stay or you leave your money. He said to them, look. And they were a group. And he had arrows and spears around him. He said, you know I am a good hitter. I can hit, you see. And I shall not surrender until I exhaust all the arrows I have, by which I shall kill a number of you. Leave me alone, and I tell you where I have hidden my wealth. Go to a certain place in Mecca and take it. This is one example of people who immigrated, joining Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they left behind all their wealth. Now, it so happened that news came from Syria that these are the circumstances for the Battle of Badr. The Prophet heard news, and they always had news. People would go around and seek news and bring them to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So one piece of news came that Abu Sufyan, he was leading a caravan of 1,000 camels with all you can imagine of trade brought from Syria to Mecca. 1,000 camels. That is worth 50,000 dinars, golden dinars. Nobody, no household in Mecca, but contributed in that caravan. So the Prophet, by the guidance of Allah Jalla Jalalu, it is Allah who commanded him to do so, as we will see in Surah Al-Anfal, you see. He commanded his companions to go, intercept the caravan and take it. It is their chance to take back the part of their wealth. A person, a leader, you see. He sent people and he knew that Muhammad was sending someone to attack the caravan. So he sent a man called Dam Dam. You look at the name, Dam Dam. Fearful name. Okay. He sent him quickly to Mecca and to warn Quraysh, come over, defend your caravan, otherwise it is lost. Dandam went on a horse or a camel, an animal. He took off his clothes as he entered Mecca and he screamed, yelled, all this. And he said, I am one of those who will strike their cheeks. Lot of my elbow. Okay. Go out. Al-Ghamza
said, help, help them. Try to save the caravan from Muhammad and his companions. So they sent over 1,000 people, warriors, you see. One leader was very old and he didn't want to go, you see. A well-known leader of Quraysh, okay. His name is Ubay ibn Khalaf, enemy of Islam. He and his brother. So they brought him. You see, it was the habit. If you want to consider someone to be a woman or a coward person, you take some bakhur, scented, you know, perfumes, and you send it, give it to him and tell him, stay a woman, you are a woman. They told Ubay ibn Khalaf, you don't deserve to go out. So they told him, you are a woman, help. So he prepared a horse and went to the army, you see. Abu Lahab, the uncle of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he did not go. And the whole army was led by Abu Jahl, Amr ibn Hisham, you see, the well-known enemy of Islam. He took over 1,000 people and wanted to face Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, who emerged from Medina with over 300 people. There were 313, exactly. This battle is very special. It was planned and executed, implemented by Allah Jalla Jalaluhu. Allah was the planner of that battle. He really made the scene, subhanahu wa ta'ala, in several ways. As we read the beginning of Surah Al-Anfal, we see this. Allah begins by the end of the battle, when he refers to it. He says, after A'udhullahi min shaitan rajeem, bismillahir rahmanir rahim, yas'alunaka 'anil anfal. They ask you about the spoils of war, what you gain from war. Now, before Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, no prophet was allowed to take spoils of war at all. You see. It was only Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the only prophet of Allah who was allowed to take spoils of war and distribute them among his companions. So Allah says here, يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْأَنْفَالِ قُلِ الْأَنْفَالُ لِلَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ. The spoils belong to Allah and His Messenger, not to you, the warriors. Okay. فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ. Have piety. وَأَصْلِحُوا ذَاتَ بَيْنِكُمْ. And look at this. This is one of the most important problems among Muslims, to reform their relationships, to make their relationships, you see, one of love and friendship rather than hatred and boycott. أَصْلِحُوا ذَاتَ بَيْنِكُمْ. Allah says, وَأَطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ إِن كُنتُم مُؤْمِنِينَ. Indeed, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he refers to this. He said, إِنَّ فَسَادَ الْبَيْنِ هِيَ الْحَالِقَةِ. Meaning that to boycott a brother or a sister or a relative or whatever, that shaves. And he said, it shaves the religion. تَحْدَقُ الْدِينِ. To have bad relationship with your relatives and to boycott them for that reason, shaves the religion, eliminates the religion. إصلاح ذات البين is the best act in the sight of Allah, which is the opposite. So Allah says here, فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهُ وَأَصْلِحُوا ذَاتَ بَيْنِكُمْ. A reference that it is only through piety that you can make the relationships good. Why? Why piety is the resource? Because it is piety that makes you part of that. When people deal with one another, they make mistakes. Things happen, bad things happen. So it is only piety that enables you or me to pardon, to forgive, for the sake of Allah. Why? This is an insult, you may say. That attitude is bad. Why should he or she do this to me? Does he mean to offend me or humiliate me? And then problems take place. They start. But the logic of believers is different. When somebody insults you, you say, well, maybe he doesn't mean this. Maybe he has a certain reason behind it. He finds excuses. He creates even excuses if there is no excuse. That is the behavior of believers. Subhanallah. So here Allah says, فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهُ وَأَصْلِحُوا ذَاتَ بَيْنِكُمْ وَأَطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ إِن كُنْتُمْ مُؤْمِنِينَ. Obey Allah and His Messenger. If at all you are believers, meaning that you cannot be believers unless and until you obey Allah and His Messenger. As in this respect, you have to reform the relationships between you and others. And then Allah gives the definition for believers. He does so in many ways in the previous Quran. Here is one of them. Who are believers? Allah says, believers are no other but the following. Innama. I said innama means inna, it is two words. Inna and ma. Inna means surely. Ma means no. So it means no other deserves the title of Iman except. This is innama. It is a sentence. Innama al-mu'minun al-ladhina idha dhukira Allah wajilat qulubuhum. Very special definition. Whenever the name of Allah is mentioned, the believers, the real believers are they whose hearts move when the name of Allah is mentioned. Look at yourself. Is your heart moved when Allah's name is mentioned? If that is the case, then thank Allah, because you have that Iman. But if it doesn't shake, it doesn't move, you don't care, or I don't care, then there is danger here. And if you are disgusted by the mentioning of the name of Allah, now here is, that is, what shall I say, condemnation. So Allah says here, وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا. Whenever the verses of Allah are recited upon believers, the verses, the revelations increase them in their iman. And what? A third quality is, وَعَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ. And they put their trust in Allah. Allah mentions five qualities of believers here. The first one is إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ. Okay. وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا. The second one. وَعَلَى رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ. Number three. الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ. Number four. وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. Number five. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ حَقًّا. These are the ones who deserve the title of Iman in truth. لَهُمْ دَرَجَاتٌ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ. They have degrees with their own. Believers are not one. Everyone has a certain degree in Iman. You see. وَمَغْفِرَةٌ وَرِزْقٌ كَرِيمٌ. This is the introduction to the battle. Then Allah refers to the battle as follows. He says, جَلَ جَلَالُ كَمَا أَخْرَجَكَ رَبُّكَ مِنْ بَيْتِكَ بِالْحَقِّ. As an example of believers who are true, you are the leader of believers, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is Allah who made you emerge from your home with truth, with a true errand and mission to go and seek that character. وَإِنَّ فَرِيقًا مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ لَكَارِهُونَ. Some believers did not like that. They disliked it. That you go out. يُجَادِلُونَكَ فِي الْحَقِّ. They argued with you about this truth. بَعْدَمَا تَبَيَّنْ. After it was clear to them. كَأَنَّمَا يُسَاقُونَ إِلَى الْمَوْتِ وَهُمْ يَنْظُرُونَ. As if they are, you see, pushed unto death while they are looking. They see themselves dragged to death. Look at the fear here. And then Allah says, referring to the caravan, وَإِذْ يَعِدُكُمُ اللَّهُ إِحْدَى الطَّائِفَتَيْنِ أَنَّهَا لَكُمْ وَتَ تودون أن غير ذات الشوكة تكون لكم. الله سبحانه وتعالى promised you that the caravan will be yours. You see. And you wish that you avoid any thorny issue, meaning any battle. الشوكة in Islam, in Arabic, means two things. شوكة literally means a thorn. And the throne is a symbol of power. So that shoka means the one with power, meaning the one with war and battle. You wish that there is no battle and that you take the caravan only in peace. وَيُرِيبُ اللَّهُ أَن يُحِقَّ الْحَقَّ بِكَلِمَاتِهِ. Allah is the platter, not you. Allah wants to establish the truth by His words, subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَيَقْفَ عَذَابِرَ الْكَافِرِينَ. And he wants to cut off the end of disbelievers. When the end of something is finished, then the whole thing is finished. لِيُحِقَّ الْحَقَّ وَيُبْطِلَ الْبَاطِلَ وَلَوْ كَرِهَ الْمُجْرِمُونَ. Allah considers the people of Quraysh to be criminals, so that Allah would establish the truth and finish falsehood. Even should disbelievers, the criminals would hate it. You see. وَلَوْ كَرِهَ الْمُجْرِمُونَ إِذْ تَسْتَغِيثُونَ رَبَّكُمْ. He used to ask Allah, the people, the companions are led by Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Before the battle, he was supplicating to Allah. He said, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, يَا رَبِّي إِنْ تَهْلِكْ هَذِهِ الْعِصَابَةِ فَلَنْ تُعْبَدَ بَعْدَ الْيَوْمِ فِي الْأَرْضِ. The Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, oh Allah, should this little group perish, then you will not be worshipped anymore and on the face of the earth. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr was behind him, and his gown fell from his shoulders, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And Abu Bakr put them back, the gown back to the shoulders of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and he said to him, بعض مناشدتك ربك والله إنه منجز لك وعده. He said to him, stop supplicating, please, sympathizing with his beloved companion Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم,